Hello viewers, my name is Dr. V. Kishan Ajay Kumar, Associate Professor from the Department of PCE in the Institute of Aeronautical Engineering, Hyderabad. Today, we are going to discuss about the topic Babinet's Principle and Slot Antenna, and we'll do some problems based upon this principle and slot antenna. So, today's topic is Babinet's Principle and Slot Antenna. Let us start our session. So, what actually is the Babinet's Principle? How this Babinet's Principle is applied for antennas? What are the applications and advantages and disadvantages of this Babinet's Principle? Let us see in the today's session. So, according to the Babinet's Principle, it states that the sum of the field at a point behind a plane having X screen and the field. So, it states that the sum of the field at a point behind a plane having a screen and the field at the same point when a complementary screen is substituted is equal to the field at the point when no screen is placed. So, whenever we add two fields, one is the original field, along with it the complementary screen is taken, and we add those two fields, it will be equal to the field, total field when no screen is placed. So, here what are the salient features of the Babinet's Principle? So, it does not consider the polarization of the antennas in establishing the field relations. That means the Babinet's Principle will not consider whether the antenna is vertically polarized or horizontally polarized. So, only the field is considered, only the field of the antennas radiating is being considered here. So, basically, it deals with absorbing screens only. It is useful to reduce the slot antenna problems to a simplified form like those of linear antennas. Let us briefly describe what this Babinet's Principle states here. See here in the figure, you can see here, suppose this is a slot here, a screen is placed here, a plane of screen here, and here, if a slot is placed along the plane of the screen, if this is a slot is placed along the plane of the screen, let us assume here, S is the point source, which is radiating the electromagnetic radiation towards the plane screen. So, here this is towards the plane screen. As we have placed here a slot here on the plane screen, only some amount of radiation is blocked by the slot. Some amount of radiation is being blocked by this slot here. The remaining amount of radiation will fall on the slot S2 here. Remaining amount of radiation from the source S will fall on the screen S2 here. So, the portion which is blocked, it is shown here by these dotted lines here. You can see here, this is the portion of the plane of the screen which is blocked by the slot here. That means the only radiation which is generating from the source S will fall on this S2 screen only, in this portion of the S2 screen only, but not on this field. And let us say again, there's a case 2 here. In the case 2 here, again, if you take any plane screen here, if we create some slot in this portion, if we are creating the slot in this portion here, these are the two slots of the plane screen here, where we have created two slots here. But here, the electromagnetic radiation, which is radiating from the source, will forward from inside this region only. That means here the radiation is falling, but in this portion the radiation is not falling here. You can see here, no radiation here. You can see here, no radiation here. That means this is known as the plane screen here. We are taking the plane screen here, and this screen we are calling it as a complementary screen. Now, let us see the case 3 here. Here, there is a point source S here. You can see here. And there is no screen here. So, when there is no screen, that is in the absence of screen, all the electromagnetic rays will directly fall on the screen here. This is the plane screen here. So, on the plane screen, so when there is no screen is placed in between the source S and the plane screen, then the total amount of radiation, entire amount of radiation will fall on the plane screen only. That means, so from this, what the Babinet's principle states here is, when we place a slot, some amount of electromagnetic field is radiated. And in the same way, here also some amount of electromagnetic field is radiated. Let us assume this as E2, and let us say this as E1 here. And here also, when there is no screen, some amount of radiation is being radiated from the point source here, let us say as E3 here. Here, we are blocking here, in the first case, this portion of the electromagnetic radiation. And here, we are blocking here, these are two slots here, which are blocking the electromagnetic rays here. And here, there is no blocking of the electromagnetic rays, as we are not placing any slot here. Here, according to the Babinet's principle, E1 plus E2 is equal to E3. That means, the electromagnetic field radiated by the point source when a slot is placed, and the summation of the electromagnetic field radiated with a complementary screen is equivalent to the electromagnetic field from the point source when no screen is placed. So this is the Babinet's principle statement. You can see here. It states that the sum of the field at a point behind a plane having a screen and the field at the same point when a complementary screen is substituted is equal to the field at the point when no screen is placed. So you can see here clearly here, there is a screen here. This is known as a complementary screen and this is no screen. That means the presence of screen plus complementary screen equivalent to absence of screen. That means the field in the presence of screen plus field in the presence of complementary screen is equivalent to field in the absence of the screen here. So this is known as the Babinet's principle. So these are the features of the Babinet's principle. You can see here, it does not consider the polarization of the antennas. It does not consider the polarization of the antennas in establishing the field relations and the field radiations. So basically, it deals with the absorbing screens only. Suppose if you take a flat conducting sheet, if we place a flat conducting sheet, this flat conducting sheet will absorb some amount of energy. That means the conductivity and the permittivity of the conducting sheet there will be some conductivity and there will be some permittivity for this sheet here, right? Suppose if we place a slot for this flat conducting sheet, right? Then the conductivity and the permittivity of the sheet will vary. So depending upon the where we are going to make the slot, it may be either horizontal, it may be or vertical. So this is known as a horizontal slot, or we can also make a vertical slot like this also. This is a vertical slot, right? So whenever we make a vertical slot also, the conductivity will vary. The conductivity of the sheet will vary. So it is useful to reduce the slot antenna problems to a simplified form like those of linear antennas. That means the more amount of radiation or efficiency can be increased by applying this Babinet's principle for a slot antennas compared to the linear antennas. So this is the basic principle of the slot antenna. And we will go for the next one. See here, the Babinet's principle. So here, you can see here, this is a plane screen here. This is case 1 here. This is generating E1 here. And this is a slot is placed in the plane of screen here. And this is the source, yes. Suppose complementary screen. So for this complementary, you can write here as like this. So here, total amount of radiation here, this is known as a complementary screen here. But here, this is a complementary screen here. So this is source, yes, here. And this is, let us assume the radiation, this radiation as E2. But this radiation as E1 here, we can assume here this as E1 here. So the Babinet's principle states that the electric field radiated by the point source when no screen is there is equal to the electric field radiated from when the slot is placed with the complementary screen. So E1 is the field behind the absorbing screen. E2 is the field behind the complementary screen. And E3 is the field when there is no screen here. So the meaning of Babinet's principle, if S1 is a plane screen, here you can see here this is S1. This S1 is a plane screen. And S2 is a plane of observation. And S is a point source here. So here, if you say here, let us say, this is, let us assume as S1, and let us assume this as S2. This is a point of observation here. This is S1. And S is the point source here. And E1 is the field at a point XYZ behind the screen here. Here, this is slot here. And here, let us assume here, this is the point of observation E1. So E1 is a field at XYZ behind the screen when S1 is placed by its complementary screen. That means, so E1 is a field at a point XYZ behind the screen here. So E2 is a field at XYZ behind the screen when S1 is replaced by its complementary screen. So for this, we can replace by S2, that is the complementary screen. And E3, let us assume as the field at the same point XYZ when no screen is present. So, according to the principle of Babinet, E3 is equal to E1 plus E2. E3 is equal to E1 plus E2. This principle is valid at the points in the plane S2 and also the points behind the screen S1. So, this principle is valid for both the screens when there is a screen and also its complementary screen. So, for both the cases, this principle holds good. And according to the Babinet's principle, when the screen and its complement are immersed in a medium whose intrinsic impedance is eta, then ZS and ZC are related by ZC into ZS is equal to eta square by 4. That means the source impedance, when we multiply with the complementary impedance of the sheet, is equal to intrinsic impedance by 4. That is eta square by 4. So this is one standard expression for the slot antenna using Babinet's principle. So ZS indicates the source impedance and ZC indicates the complementary impedance. Suppose if you take this is a sheet here, right? So for this sheet, there will be ZS and ZC. That means the source impedance and the complementary impedance is equal to the intrinsic impedance. It is given by eta square by 4. And let us apply this Babinet's principle to the slot antenna here. So a type of antenna with an opening cut of certain dimensions in a metallic conductor which is used using a two-way transmission line or coaxial cable is known as a slot antenna. That means, so whenever we want to design a slot antenna, you take a flat conducting sheet, and if you cut this sheet horizontally like this, so this becomes a slot antenna. So a type of antenna with an opening cut. So this is known as the opening cut at certain dimensions in a metallic conductor which is excited using a two-way transmission line or coaxial cable is known as the slot antenna. So these antennas operate in the frequency range between 300 MHz to 30 GHz. So it is generally found by making an elongated slot cut of lambda by 2 length and width with very less than lambda by 2 in a metallic conductive sheet. So the length of this slot is cut in such a way that the length is approximately lambda by 2 and the width is less than lambda by 2 in a metallic conducting sheet. So the excitation to the slot is provided at the center or half of the center, Suppose if you take this as metallic conducting sheet, here there is a slot here. So here the excitation for this slot, it is given exactly at the center. So exactly here, if you take a coaxial cable here, so one conductor, it is given to the one portion of the slot, the other one is given to the conducting sheet here. So this is how to excite the slot antenna. By means of the coaxial cable. Horizontal slot antenna provides a vertically polarized signal, while a vertical slot antenna gives a horizontally polarized signal. So here, a horizontal slot antenna provides a vertically polarized signal, while a vertical slot antenna gives a horizontally polarized signal. See here, you can see here, if this is how the polarization depends. The polarization of this slot antenna depends upon how we cut this slot, whether horizontally or vertically. Suppose, let us assume here, this is a flat conducting sheet here. If this flat conducting sheet, we are going to cut this horizontally. Let us, for this, this is the plane conducting sheet. For this plane conducting sheet, the complementary antenna, the complementary slot is, we can take it as, this is the complementary. So, this is the complementary. We can see here, this complementary antenna just resembles, it is like a dipole antenna. It resembles like a dipole antenna, which is horizontally polarized. Which is horizontally polarized. That means the dipole is appearing like this here. So for this dipole, this is horizontal. As this dipole is horizontal, its radiation pattern will be vertical like this. Its radiation pattern will be vertical like this. That means this is the dipole is vertically polarized. The dipole is vertically polarized. Right? So here from this, as this dipole antenna, it is the complementary of this case 1. This is 1 and this is 2. So 2 is the complementary of 1. 2 is the complementary of 1. So from this, we can say that the slot antenna, if we want to get horizontally polarized wave, so we need to place this in the horizontal direction. So you can see here the statement here, a horizontal slot antenna provides a vertically polarized signal. A horizontal slot antenna provides a vertically polarized signal. While a vertical slot antenna gives a horizontally polarized signal. So here, if this is, as this dipole antenna, it is horizontal. It gives vertical, it gives a radiation pattern perpendicular to the horizontal direction. Exactly opposite to this, this slot antenna will behave. That means, for this, the polarization will be like this. As these both 1 and 2 are complementary, as these both are 1 and 2 are complementary, for this dipole, we know that this is, the dipole is horizontal. As the dipole is horizontal, the radiation pattern will be like this. So, from this case 2, we can say that for case 1, the radiation pattern will be perpendicular like this. Why? Because 1 and 2 are complementary to each other. Let us see another case, how the polarization of the slot antenna will vary here. Suppose if you take this is a flat conducting sheet here. If we make a slot vertical here, this is case 1 here. And this is the complementary. As this is the complementary, so this is resembles like a, this resembles like a dipole antenna. So this is vertically polarized here. As vertically polarized here, the electric field will be perpendicular to this antenna. So this is the radiation pattern for this vertical dipole antenna. So as the radiation pattern is horizontal, and we know that 1 and 2 are complementary to each other. So, for this 1, the radiation pattern will be exactly opposite to the 2. That means, for 1, the radiation pattern will be exactly opposite to the radiation pattern of the case 2 here. Why? Because 1 and 2 are complementary to each other. Right? So, according to our requirements, we can make a slot. So, whether we want vertically polarization or horizontally polarization, we can make a slot as horizontal inside the conducting sheet or vertical for inside the conducting sheet. So, overall, you can say here, a horizontal slot antenna provides a vertically polarized signal. A horizontal slot antenna provides a vertically polarized signal. And here, a vertical slot antenna gives the horizontally polarized signal. A vertically polarized slot antenna gives the horizontally polarized signal here. So these are the two cases which we can derive the radiation pattern of the slot antenna from the Babinet's principle. So, slot antennas operating on the principle whenever a high frequency field is present across a slot in a metallic sheet, then energy is radiated. So, this operates on the principle of Babinet's principle here. On the principle of Babinet, whenever a high frequency field is present across the slot in a metallic conducting sheet, the energy is radiated. The energy is radiated. So, you can see here. So, then energy is radiated. This is the reason. So, if we apply the electric field here, if we apply the electric field by means of the coaxial cable here, one is connected to the directly, one conductor, inner conductor is connected directly to the slot antenna. The other conductor is connected only to the flat conducting sheet here, flat conducting sheet. So, automatically the slot antenna gets into excitation and energy is radiated. So, this is the reason when a slot is cut from the surface of the conducting plate, then on energizing the slot, the electromagnetic wave is radiated, thus acts as an antenna, thus acts like an antenna. So, due to the presence of the slot, it is named as a slot antenna. So, as there is a slot here, you can see here, this region, we call it as a slot. As due to the presence of the slot, we can name it as a slot antenna. Thus, we can say that a conductive surface with a slot of a particular dimensions is referred to as a slot antenna. A conductive surface with a slot of particular dimensions is referred to as a slot antenna here. Suppose we have a rectangular conductive sheet over which a horizontal slot is cut having length lambda by 2 and the breadth extremely less than lambda by 2 and let it be W. So, this half wavelength resembles as a half wave dipole antenna according to the radiation and gain. However, the slot antenna and half wave dipole antenna show variation according to the polarization. So, however, the slot antenna and the half wave dipole antenna show variation according to the polarization. That means whether we are placing the antenna vertically or horizontally. So, the polarization of the waves will be changing continuously when we change the direction of the antenna. So, here always the length of the slot in most of the practical applications we use it as a lambda by 2 and the width is taken as less than lambda by 2. The length is designated as L and the width is designated as W for the slot antenna here. The slot antenna follows the Babinet's principle here. The working of the slot antenna you can see here. The slot antenna follows the Babinet's principle. So, here the Babinet proposed that two complementary screens generate a similar diffraction pattern. This is known as the Babinet's principle. So, here there is a, in the between you can see here a slot is made for the flat conducting sheet here. This is the two wire transmission line here. One is connected to one region. One wire is connected to the one side of the slot and the other one is connected to the other side of the slot here. Right, so this is the balanced transmission. This is known as the balanced wire transmission line. It is given as the input to the slot, which is made from the flat conducting sheet. So, according to this principle, the structure of the slot antenna and the half wave dipole structure cut out from the conducting sheet are complementary to each other. Here, the current distribution for the dipole antenna. We know that whenever we are going to cut the antenna in the form of slot here. This resembles a dipole antenna. So, this can be redrawn as like this here. We know that the current distribution is maximum at the center and the current will be minimum at the ends of the dipole antenna. Here you can see here. Here the current is minimum. Here the current is maximum here. Right. So, this is the radiation pattern of the dipole antenna where we can draw like this. When the slot is horizontal, when we place the slot as the horizontal, the radiation pattern is maximum at the center like this, right? So, as the slot is horizontal here, the radiation pattern is vertical here. So, exactly opposite to this, the slot antenna radiation will be here. Suppose if we take this as a slot here, as we are placing the slot horizontally, the radiation pattern will be exactly opposite to this. That means, so this is the 1 and this is the 2. So, we need to know the radiation pattern of the slot antenna based upon the dipole antenna. So, by seeing the dipole antenna radiation pattern, we can see how the radiation pattern of the slot antenna will appear. So the figure below presents the slot and the complementary dipole antenna. You can here, you can see here the slot antenna here. It is a dipole antenna here. A transmission line is placed here. And a slot antenna and the complementary dipole antenna. Here, this is the total length is taken as a lambda by 2 here. A transmission line is fixed in order to give the input signal to the flat conducting sheet or a slot antenna. Here, this is on the width of the slot antenna. This is the slot antenna. This is the length and this is the W. Length and width. Here, the external field which is used as excitation is provided at the center of the slot using the two-wire transmission line. Using the two-wire transmission line. So, we can use two-wire transmission line directly. One wire is attached to one side, the other wire is attached to the other side. So, these are two wires, one and two here. So, this is one and this is two. So, this is a two-wire transmission line here. So, this is one form of a feeding of the slot antenna here. And in another form, we can also use a coaxial cable for feeding the slot antenna here. If this is a flat conducting sheet, if we make a slot here, one inner conductor of the coaxial cable, it is connected to one side of the slot antenna. And the other one, it is given to the, this is one, this is two for the coaxial cable. So, one inner conductor is given as the input to the any side of the slot here, one. And the outer conductor of the coaxial cable is given to the conducting flat conducting sheet at any point. You can see here, these two can be located here also, the corner also. Here also, we can locate two here. That is the outer conductor. The outer conductor of the cable, you can connect it to the conducting sheet at any place. The impedance of the slot antenna depends upon the feed position. The impedance of the slot antenna depends upon the feed point position. As the impedance shows reduction with the shift of feed point towards the edge from the center, it is noteworthy that the radiation pattern of the slot and the dipole are similar to the each other. So, the impedance of the slot antenna depends upon where we are going to exactly feed. That means the impedance of the conducting sheet, the impedance of the slot must be equivalent. That means wherever we are going to feed the transmission line, that means the feed, the impedance of the transmission line must be equivalent to the impedance of the slot antenna. So, in such a way, we need to feed the, we need to place the transmission line in the flat conducting sheet. So, here, the radiation pattern of the slot and the dipole are similar to each other, but complementary to each other. However, the electric field will be vertically polarized for the slot, while horizontally polarized by the for the dipole here. So, here, there are as we have discussed, that is the parabolic reflector, we will see two problems based upon this reflector antenna. So, here, we can see here, the paraboloid reflector is 1.8 meters diameter. It is used at a 6 gigahertz. Calculate the beam width between the nulls and gain in dB. So, we know that the parabolic reflector, it resembles like this in a two-dimensional. And we can also represent this as a three-dimensional like this. This is a three-dimensional representation. This is the 2D, two-dimensional representation of the parabolic reflector antenna. And for this parabolic reflector antenna, the diameter is given as 1.8 meters. So, this is the diameter in the three-dimensional. This is D is equal to 1.8 meters is given. Now, what is the beam width between the nulls and what is the gain of the parabolic reflector? We are going to find out in the problem. So, here the frequency is given as 6 gigahertz. The input frequency that we are going to give for this reflector is 6 gigahertz. So, F is equal to 6 gigahertz V naught. And we know that C is equal to F lambda here. C is equal to F lambda. That means the velocity is equivalent to the product of frequency and the wavelength. So, based upon this expression, we can find out the value of lambda. Lambda is equal to C by F, that is equal to 3 into 10 power 8 by 6 into 10 power 9 is equal to 0.05 meters. So, just we substitute the velocity, we know that the velocity is equal to 3 into 10 power 8 and the frequency, given frequency is 6 into 10 power 9. If we simplify, we will get the wavelength, that is 0.05 meters. And in order to calculate the beam width of the parabolic reflector antenna, we are having a formula, that is the beam width between the first nulls, BWFN. It is designated as a BWFN. That means beam width between the first nulls, it is given as 140 lambda by D. 140 lambda by D. So, is equal to 140 into 0.05 by 1 by 1.8. So we know that the lambda is calculated as 0.05 meters. And the given the diameter is dimensions of the diameter of the parabolic reflector, it is given as 1.8 meters. If we simplify this, you will get 3.89 degrees. We'll simplify it, you will get the 3.89 degrees. So this is the beam width between the first nulls. So beam width between the first nulls. So here the beam width between the first nulls is nothing but from the radiation pattern, if this is the parabolic reflector antenna, if this is the radiation pattern here, these are known as first nulls here. These are known as the first nulls here. These both are known as first nulls. This is known as the major lobe here. And this angle from the between the first nulls, this angle we call it as BWFN. BWFN. So this BWFN is nothing but 3.89 degrees for the diameter of 1.8 meters of diameter. At a frequency of 6 GHz, we are going to get the BWFN as 3.89 degrees. And similarly, if we want to find out the gain of the parabolic reflector antenna, we are having a formula 4 pi A0 by lambda square, where A0 is equal to Ka. A0 is equal to Ka. So here A represents the actual area and A0 represents the effective area where the amount of absorption takes place. Only some portion of the absorption takes place for a parabolic reflector antenna. That area we call it as the A0 or capture area, which is equal to the Ka. K is 0.65 for a dipole antenna. If we take dipole as a feed antenna for the parabolic reflector antenna. So here, we know that the diameter is represented as a D here. As we know that the area is equal to pi R square. And we know that D is equal to 2R. R is equal to D by 2 here. R is equal to D by 2 here. If we substitute this R value in this expression, you will get A is equal to pi into D by 2 whole square. So overall, you will get pi D square by 4. Pi d square by 4, you will get the value of A, that is area is equal to pi d square by 4. So if we know that A0 is equal to Ka, we substitute this value in this formula A0. So A0 is equal to Ka, but A is equal to pi d square by 4. A is equal to pi d square by 4. So we substitute all these values in this formula, you will get the gain of the parabolic reflector antenna as 83.14547. So you can see here, if you substitute 4 pi into k, well, the value of k is 0.65 into a0 is equal to k, a0 is equal to ka. What is a? The pi d square. So pi into 1.8 whole square by 4 into lambda square. We just now have substituted lambda square as 0.05. So 0.05 whole square. So if we simplify all these numerator and the denominator, you will get the value as 8314.1547. So we can also convert this in terms of dB here, as the value is larger. We are going to represent this in terms of dB, the gain of the reflector, 10 log GP here. So GP in dB, we can also represent in terms of dB as 10 log GP. This is equal to 10 log of 8314.14 in dB here, base 10 here. Okay, so we can simplify here. We can also represent in terms of dB here. So this is how to find out the gain and the beam width between the first nulls of the parabolic reflector antenna. So the gain is given by 4 pi A0 by lambda square. And the beam width is given by 140 into lambda by d. So for each of the problems, the frequency will be given here. Always the frequency is given for the input as input signal to the reflector antenna or any type of antenna. So based upon the frequency, we can find out the value of lambda here. That is, lambda is equal to C by F. And we are having two formulas here. This beam width between the first nulls and the gain of the parabolic reflector antenna here. So this is the value is common if we take dipole antenna as the feeding element. See here, we can see here the parabolic reflector antenna. We need to excite this parabolic reflector here. We need to excite this parabolic reflector here. So if we change the design here, like if we change like this here. So this element which we are going to feed, it is nothing but the dipole antenna here. This is the dipole antenna here, whose K value is equal to 0.65. Whose K value is equal to 0.65 here. So based upon the K value, we are going to substitute the K value of 0.65 in this equation. A0 is equal to K A. So thus the power gain in dB, it is given by 10 log GP, it is equal to 10 log 83.14.1547. This is equal to 39.1987 dB. 39.1987 dB. Similarly, we can also find out for this case where the frequency is given as a 3 GHz. In the second case, the frequency is given as 3 GHz. So for 3 GHz, the value of lambda is given by 3 into 10 power 8 by 3 into 10 power 9 is equal to 0.1 meters. So again, we know we are having the formula B width between the first nonce, it is given as 140 lambda by D. So we substitute this value of lambda here. We are going to substitute the value of lambda here. And the required diameter is given as 0.1 here. We do not know the diameter here, but the beam width is given here in this case. So in this problem, the beam width is given as a 10 degrees here. We are going to substitute this 10 degrees here. And based upon the data available, we are going to find out the value of D here. So the data, according to the given data, we know that the frequency is given as 3 GHz, and the beam width, it is given as 10 degrees. If we substitute the value of lambda here and the frequency and the beam width between the first nulls here, you will get the value of D, that is the diameter of the parabolic reflector antenna. So it is given as 1.4 meters. So the diameter is calculated as 1.4 meters. So again, the gain is given as 4 pi into A0 by lambda square here. And we know that the gain of the parabolic reflector is given by 4 pi into A0 by lambda square, where A0 is equal to Ka. And K is equal to 0.65 here. And A is equal to area of the parabolic reflector. It is given as circle. The aperture is circular. So we can write it as pi d square by 4. Pi d square by 4 here. So if you substitute and simplify, you will get the gain as 30.9947 dB. So if you substitute the values of D and A0 is equal to K, K is equal to 0.65, you will get the values as 30.9947 dB. And similarly, the directivity of the parabolic for the circular motion is given by pi d by lambda whole square. So pi d by lambda whole square, you will get 8.8589. Pi d by lambda whole square is given by 8.8589. So with this, we close the session today here. So today we have discussed about the Babinet's principle and also the slot antenna. Thank you.
Like, share and subscribe. Hit the bell icon for more updates.